Rockin' Nitus. Hi, cats and kittens. Welcome to Rockinitis. My name is Michael Wilmore. I've been doing this show for a while now, and even though I walk among you, one of the nice things about doing this show is that I hardly ever get recognized. But when I do get recognized, people say, you know, you look a lot better in person than you do on TV. Three people have actually told me that. And I think that might be the same as saying, you know, you don't look any good on TV. My special guest this time out is Rob Frith, who has a record store on Main Street. Between 19th and 20th?
That's right, yeah.
On Main? You've been doing that for a long time now? And
over 25 years.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not in that location.
No, there for 4 years. Mm-hmm. Moved about 4 years ago.
And the shop specializes in memorabilia and
records, CDs, memorabilia, mm-hmm. new vinyl, you know, pretty much everything, books, anything music related.
Now, you had a guy working in the store for the longest period, a guy called Scotty Hall.
That's right.
Who actually I became quite good friends with over the years. And I got a couple little mini stories about Scotty. He was kind of a prominent member of Vancouver's rock and roll community, if there is such a thing.
He's one of the kind of behind-the-scenes guitar players that mm-hmm. played on a lot of really famous commercials and played on other people's records, but also was in the band Idle Eyes.
Mm-hmm. He was lead guitar in Idle Eyes?
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. And they had a couple of hits mm-hmm. and did videos and that kind of thing. Yeah. I used to run into Scotty a lot of times at different rock and roll shows, and I saw Jeff Beck at the Commodore.
Oh, yeah.
And I was there with a couple other people, and I hear this voice way behind me yell out, "You're the greatest!" So I turned around to see who it was, and it was Scotty.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, Scotty and I actually lucked out. We met Jeff Beck together backstage one time.
At that show?
Or? No, at a different show. Mm-hmm. I'd known people in the music business for years, and I'd never really asked for any favors, but mm-hmm. I knew Scotty was this huge Jeff Beck fan, and he'd worked for me for quite a while. And so I pulled in some favors and got backstage passes when he was playing once. And so we actually got to meet Jeff Beck.
Oh, gee, he must have melted in front of Jeff Beck.
I know how much he idolized him. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Anyway, he was a beautiful man, made beautiful music, and he had a CD out that maybe
you could show
people.
Yeah, just before he passed away, it basically we got it the day that he found out he had cancer. So we put the whole thing together and... Mm-hmm. And we found out the day that he found out he had cancer, that's the day we got the CD. And it wasn't long after, just a few months later, that he passed away.
But yeah, I still think of him, and I miss him.
Yeah.
And you don't sort of realize how much somebody means to you until they're no longer there, you know?
That's right.
And it's so hard to come to grips with the fact that they're no longer there.
Yeah, it really is. And for me, because, I saw him every day. I mean, mm-hmm. Every day I come in and there he would, he'd be there. And so, it took, it's still, every time I go into the store, I find it very difficult
to... You might have to put a downward tilt on it there.
I find it very difficult to him not being there. Mm-hmm. It's just amazing. After, over 25 years.
Anyway, great musician and great friend. And it's very sorry to see him go. He was also a really big Beatles fan.
Oh, yeah, huge.
Now, I always thought people that were just into the Beatles were a little myopic. Because it seems like the first thing you would ever get into is the Beatles, because that's the first thing put on your plate.
Yeah.
So, but with Scotty, I said, you know, well, there's a lot of other people out there. How come you like the Beatles so much? And he says, two lead singers.
That's
so
very
I thought,
true.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah. We're going to deal with a group this time out on Rockinitis with two lead singers. It's the Nashville Teens, and the two lead singers were Arthur Sharp on vocals and Ray Phillips on bass guitar, harmonica, and vocals. And they were formed in 1962 in Weybridge in Surrey, and they got their name from the Everly Brothers song Nashville Blues. And they decided to use the term Nashville along with the term teens to make them seem
and they thought youthful, that also that some of the best music was coming out of Nashville, and they thought, you mm-hmm. know, a lot of people would think that too, and they were teenagers.
Yeah, and everybody, I suppose, when they first got their hit records, on the turntable, they would have thought probably in the States that they were in fact from Nashville.
That's
but
right.
They weren't. They were from England. Yeah. Weybridge and
I Surrey. Remember the first time I saw them actually was 1965. My friend's dad took us to go, I'm pretty sure it was to go see Help, the Beatles mm-hmm. movie, and they had a short movie before it called Go-Go Mania.
Okay.
And that's the first time I'd ever seen, probably the first time I'd ever heard the Nashville Teens was in that movie. Actually, I'd heard the song before, the Tobacco Road,
mm-hmm.
but I actually saw
them.
That
was their big hit.
Yeah.
Anyway, they first started off, the very first record they ever did was they backed up Jerry Lee Lewis on his Live at the Star Club LP, which is one of the greatest live albums ever done, that's for sure. And you can hear Jerry Lee Lewis actually introducing himself and the fact that he's at the Star Club. And this is High School Confidential, Jerry Lee Lewis backed up by the Nashville Teens.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to say it's a pleasure, a great honor to be back at the fabulous, most beautiful, I mean really swinging, Star Club. All right. Yeah. You better open up, honey, get your lover boy me that's knocking. You better listen to me, sugar roller, catch the red to high school of rocket. Honey, get your bobbing shoes so that you can box the blows a few. Got everybody hopping, everybody bopping, bopping up a high school house. Oh, bopping up a high school house, shaking up a high school house. I've been a rolling up a high school house. I've been a moving up a high school house. Heard everybody hopping, man, I'm bopping, just a bopping, and I'm bopping up a high school house. I'm on a little bit, I'm gonna rock a little bit tonight. Whoa, I gotta get the wind and shook, I'm gonna shake things up tonight.
That's the Nashville Teens backing up Jerry Lee Lewis on a great live cut recorded in Hamburg, Germany at the Star Club. And if you look at the cover photo here, there's Jerry Lee Lewis at the piano, his pumping piano, as it said on the records. And you can see the drummer Barry Jenkins in the background. He later left the group and joined the Animals. And somewhere around here, I've got the
and they really album. They really felt it when he left the band too.
Yeah,
he was considered one of the better drummers around.
This is him here. This is Barry Jenkins, right there. And he later left the group and joined the Animals and replaced John Steele, who was leaving the group. Also, there's a new member here, Dave Rowberry, who replaced Alan Price, the organ player, when he left. Just a kind of a little interesting aside there. There were some personnel shakeups in the Nashville Teens. The album that they had out, though, the main release of theirs, produced by Mickey Most, has some really wonderful things on it, and it has one of those kind of Beatlesque album covers where they're all jumping up into the air.
And Mickey Most also produced the Animals.
Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
Which is probably where they lost their drummer.
Right. Anyway, at this time he was very much still a member of the band. We're going to play three tracks from the album because it's just so great. This was one of my favorite albums back in the 1960s. So we'll hear Bread and Butter Man, which is led by the rhythmic and propulsive drumming of Barry Jenkins of the Nashville Teens. Tracks there from an absolutely marvelous album. I just played the heck out of this album back in the 1960s. It was as good as a Stones album, I thought, at the time. Three tracks, Bread and Butter Man, How Deep is the Ocean, and Mona. Now, the Stones did Mona, yeah. And it was originally a Bo Diddley tune, but I think the Nashville Teens version is even a little hotter than the Stones
version.
Yeah,
they do a great version.
What a
great band. The guys are really good players. And you really notice the keyboard player sounds like Jerry Lee Lewis.
Yes, he's got on that cut, he plays a harpsichord. And the pianist's name is John Hawken.
That's right.
And he later left to join Keith Relf's
Renaissance.
And I've got their album.
And the Straubs and Vinegar Joe with Robert Palmer, I think, was in that band.
Anyway, he later left to join Renaissance. There's the front cover there. And actually, I'm going to show the back one in a second, too, because the back of it.
I think Keith Relf was only on the first Renaissance album, wasn't he?
I'm not sure, too. This is the only album I've got by Renaissance. This is Keith Relf in the center with his gorgeous sister standing beside him. And the pianist John Hawken left to join Keith Relf's Renaissance about a year after this album came out, the Nashville Teens LP.
And he was a classically trained musician as well.
So okay.
I think that's why he sort of got in with those sort of progressive bands, because he was able to play, you know, extremely well.
Now, the Nashville Teens were in several movies. I don't know if you collect movies, I know.
Yeah, yeah.
Have you ever seen Pop Gear?
Yeah, it's the same as Go-Go Mania.
Oh, is it the same
movie?
Yeah,
it's an English title.
With a different title.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. It was called Pop Gear in England, and then here they called it Go-Go Mania.
Well, they also were on Ready, Steady, Go a lot.
Yeah.
And they were in another movie called Be My Guest from 1965.
Yeah, I've never seen that one. I've never been able
to. Is that after the Fats Domino song, Be My Guest?
I don't know. I don't know.
And
that.
Then there was another movie called Beach Ball, which was a U.S. movie.
Yeah.
Have you seen
that? Yeah, I have that one.
Okay, well, they're
I forgot the Nashville Teens were
in it. Yeah, they're
in it. The Animals, I think, are in there. So it must have been...
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. I like those old movies, just for the appearances of
You know,
these guys.
Well, that's why I collected them.
Less. Anyway, they backed up Chuck Berry and Carl Perkins and Bo Diddley when they came to England. And in 2000, the Repertoire label released a really nice CD that you have there.
Yeah, this one.
And
it has all the bonus tracks and stuff.
And I've got a sort of a comparable collection here. Now, I actually was checking out your CD. I think your CD is actually a little superior to mine.
Well, it has like almost as many bonus tracks as there are regular tracks.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe even more. It's amazing. That Repertoire label does that.
Yeah.
They can find all these really cool, like...
Yeah, well, I was impressed with yours because it's got a totally different set of bonus tracks than mine does.
Yeah.
But most of the... yours has got the entire of the album of plus bonus tracks, and mine has like half of this album plus bonus tracks, and it's a lot less tracks when you add it all up. Anyway, their absolute biggest hit they had was Tobacco Road, which came out on the London record label. And
which was written by John D. Loudermilk, who was a really sort of actually low-key songwriter who wrote a lot of big hits.
John D. Loudermilk tried being an artist himself. He did the original version of Sitting in the Balcony, which was covered in short order by Eddie Cochran. And Eddie Cochran's version, of course, blew him right out of the water. So then he just decided, I think, to be a songwriter from that point.
Yeah.
But anyway, the song was covered a couple of years later by Jefferson Airplane, and they do a really wonderful version too. But this is the tune that everybody remembers the Nashville Teens for. A wonderful song all about being down and out and coming from the wrong side of the tracks.
Yeah, I actually really like the Jefferson Airplane version as
I do. I like it just as much.
It's a little bit different, but yeah, I think so. They're
both versions are wonderful. Yeah. Anyway, a wonderful, great classic from the 1960s, Tobacco Road. Jefferson Airplane with their marvelous version of that great tune, written by John D. Loudermilk. The odd thing is that the Jefferson Airplane version is credited to somebody entirely different. It says on their version, Clay Warnick.
Really? I never
noticed
that.
That's what it says.
That.
Look at the composer credits. Clay Warnick.
Funny. Wow.
Isn't that funny?
That is really
anyway,
bizarre.
It is a John D. Loudermilk tune, and John D. Loudermilk wrote lots of great stuff. And actually, I went to see Jefferson Airplane at the time that...
There's a picture of John D. Loudermilk here, too. Oh, looking up pretty straight.
That's John D. Loudermilk?
Yeah.
Okay, let me... I haven't even seen that.
Oh, okay. You'll watch the show. It's pretty good.
Yeah, watch the show later. Anyway, turn it, so let's see. Oh, okay, so he's a kind of a nerdy-looking bookworm sort of type.
But he had that sort of hit called Roadhog, too, I think, later
on. I don't think I've heard that.
Oh, you'd know it if you heard it.
Anyway, this is Simone Signa Anderson, who is the original lead singer of Jefferson Airplane.
You should know that name, Michael.
Why?
You won a trip to Reno answering that question.
Oh, that's right. That's right. We were on a TV show 100 years ago, and the prize was a trip to Reno, and they wanted to know who the original lead singer was.
That's right. And you won against Howie Vickers.
Oh, that's true. He didn't know. Yeah. Anyway, she's the lady that's in the group here, and she was, she was from the Pacific Northwest.
That's
I'm
right.
not really positive where in the Pacific
yeah,
Northwest.
Yeah, I wasn't sure. It was either like Seattle or Portland.
I think it might be Portland.
Yeah.
But anyway, she was a really ballsy lead singer and had a lot of drive and projection and, you know, like she really belted it out and was a wonderful lead singer. And I saw the group with that lineup at the Queen Elizabeth Theater with Muddy Waters and the Tom Northcott Trio.
Yeah.
And here's a little ad that I cut out of the Vancouver Sun back in those days, back in 1966.
I have the poster for that show.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
Oh, you should have brought it along.
Yeah, I should have.
Anyway, the Nashville Teens actually had 5 UK hits. In 1964, they had Tobacco Road, which made number 6, and Google Eye, which made number 10. And 1965, they had Find My Way Back Home, which made number 34, and This Little Bird, which was also covered by
Marianne Faithful,
which made number 38, and 1966, The Hard Way, which made number 45. And all of those later things are available on this second Nashville Teens album.
That's a cool one.
It's not as good as the first album, but it is good and it's worth picking up. Just for the fact that it's got a lot of their more obscure later things on it. And the follow-up to Tobacco Road was Google Eye, which was another John D. Loudermilk composition, and it's about going, this is the single here, it's about going fishing and trying to catch a famous fish called Google Eye. And the B-side is also really nice too, so we'll hear that one. The Nashville Teens, 1964.
Jump in my old Jeep wagon, bump it to the banks of the river. Dig me a worm and a crooked squirm and wade out into the water. Oh, goodbye, Google Eye. Eat him up, Google Eye, Google Eye, Google Eye. Eat him up, Google Eye, Google Eye, Google Eye. Goodbye, Google Eye. Bait me a hook in the water.
That's a song called TNT, which is very punkoid.
Oh, yeah. I think that's one of their best things.
Yeah. And it's the B-side of Google Eye, which you can only get on the single. It's not on an album. And there's a great book out here by Terry Rawlings called British Beat, 1960 to 1969. And there's a wonderful photo of the Nashville Teens from about 1966, after the change in personnel, after the two members had left the group and they got two new members in, that's what the Nashville Teens looked like. Now, in 1965, I saw the Nashville Teens live. They were on the same bill with the Zombies. And one other group that I just can't remember what the other group was, but there was three groups. I saw them at the Queen Elizabeth Theater, 1965. And the Nashville Teens had some kind of visa problem. So they weren't able to go to the States. So the Zombies and the other group went on to the States, and then Asheville Teens had to return to England. So they only played the Canadian dates.
That's right. They had to, they talked their way into being able to do a show. They were supposed to be on some TV show.
Mm-hmm.
And they managed to talk the government or the customs into letting them do the show, but they couldn't play any live shows.
Oh.
So they actually got to do one TV performance or something like that.
Anyway, I did see them at the Queen Elizabeth Theatre, and it was wonderful, and that's why I'm such a fan.
Yeah.
Even today. Anyway, the group broke up finally in 1973, and they reformed in 1980 and had this album here, the Nashville Teens at the live at the Red House. This was recorded live with absolutely no overdubs in 1982. At Howard Hill in Essex by the Sound Advice Mobile Unit. And we'll hear one track off the album to go out with. It's, in fact, their cover version of Jimi Hendrix's Red House. And that's quite fitting because it was recorded live at the Red House. So this has been a show on the Nashville Teens, one of my favorite, somewhat obscure groups, although they did have 1 million seller and 500,000 seller with Google Eye. And we'll go out with Red House by the Nashville Teens. Thanks very much for being here, Rob.
It was fun as usual.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.
Rockin' Nitus.